have looked at the relationship between language and computers. We have studied language, we have seen several components of language, and in this course we are looking at the applicational aspects of those components of the study of language in various domains of society and our lives. In order to understand that, last time we discussed an interaction between language and computers, that is language and machines. We touched upon very fundamental relationship between the two, and we only looked at some of the areas where such an interaction has contributed to some extent. We also tried to understand the encoding and decoding and production and understanding system and the requirement of interpretations at pragmatic level and the capabilities of machines in dealing with the structural ambiguities involved and the parsing of chunks of the structure the way human brain does when we study human language, when we have developed theories in the study of human language, that is natural language, which can contribute to a great extent. We have seen some of these aspects. Today, I invite you to listen to a talk by Dr. Amit Sethi, who teaches at the Department of Electrical and Electronics Engineering at the Indian Institute of Technology, Guwahati. He works in computer vision and making machines more intelligent for a variety of functions. He is going to talk about how spell checkers have developed in this area of language and computers and how it works. That will give us an insight into applicability of the interactions between language and computers. So, listen to this, and like I mentioned in the last module, that you come up with more areas on your own as exercise for this domain of computer science and the study of language, that what are those areas, to some extent new areas, where such an interaction has potential to contribute in making machines more intelligent and changing the lives further. Thank you.
Good morning everyone, and thank you for having me here. I will give a talk on natural language processing through an example, how spell checkers work, and it will, I'll try to make the talk, keep it simple, partly because I'm also not an expert in NLP. I do teach a little bit of NLP in my machine learning course, but hopefully this will be accessible to everyone. So what is NLP? What do you understand by NLP? Basically, I want to get to what is the difference between NLP and computational linguistics. Okay, so NLP is actually an engineering discipline. It is basically solving problems of understanding natural language text, okay, using engineering methods. So it uses linguistics. So for example, it could be used for machine translation, spell check or autocorrect, automated query analysis. You ask computer a question and it will give you an answer. Even things like automated speech recognition uses natural language processing, speech parsing, right? So that overlaps with ASL. And it is based on probability and statistics, machine learning, linguistics, and of course, common sense. Right? How is it different from computational linguistics? Computational linguistics is a linguistic, it's a discipline in linguistics, where you are forming mathematical and computational languages, computational models for language. And you are using computational methods to understand the nature of language itself and to understand how language is acquired. So it's like computational biology. You are actually doing biology, but using computational method. So that is computational linguistics, doing linguistics using computational method. So their goals are very different. NLP, on the other hand, is an engineering discipline. So I just gave some examples. So like this parse tree will be very familiar to some of the people here. That comes from linguistics. Whereas this is NLP, where you are taking some text in a language and translating it into another language. Okay. So we will start with a discussion on what is a language model and how that is useful in our main topic, which is spell checkers. But before we get to spell checkers, I want to talk about some computational models of a language, which may be which are mainly coming from NLP side, not from computational linguistics side. So we will, let's start with an exercise. Can you predict the next word? I'll give you a word in a sentence, and I'll give you word at a time, and let's see if you can predict the next word. Okay, what do most sentences start with? The most, right? So the stocks fell again today for a third, what? Third time. Could it be third minute? No, right? Nobody looks at stock every minute unless you are a high frequency trader. Okay. Third day or third time in this week. Okay. So you can guess what the next word is coming. Right? It's not you given the context, given the previous words, you have a very good idea of what is coming. Okay. But how do we do that? We do that based on several types of knowledge, right? We have domain knowledge. For example, third day versus third minute. You didn't say third minute because you know that when you read news about stocks, it's day to day, not minute to minute news. Okay. And then syntactic knowledge. So here, what I mean by this is like there's an a, which is here, and when you talk about this third, third is an adjective, and you know that what is coming next is a noun. Okay. So because of that, you know what word is coming next. So language is fundamental to how our brains work. Even an illiterate person, you know, they don't have to be Panini or Noam Chomsky. Even an illiterate person, when they hear parts of a sentence, they know what is coming next, right? So it's very fundamental to us. And this comes from experience of lots of conversational sentences, right? And our goal is to find out how can a machine gain such an experience, okay? And how will that experience be modeled, and what will it be used for? And of course, it will be used for spell checking also. Okay. So I want to start with a very simple probabilistic model of a language. So please don't get too bothered by the mathematical constructs that you see there. They're pretty simple. I'll explain very quickly. Okay. So we'll start with a notion of probability of a word. What does that mean? Which words are more frequent? Those words have high probability. So we are just looking at count of word in, let's say, all the sentences that you have heard in your life. The count of, if you take all the words, the ones that will be most frequent will probably be one of some of these, right? A and the articles, prepositions, and so forth. A word like obsequious will probably be very improbable. You probably have heard it maybe two times in your life, right? So we already know that if we have a word W, then it has a probability associated with it. What is M? M is, let's say you have a sentence or a document or a conversation. It is the mth word, starting with W1, W2, W3, up to M. So the probability of word WM is some probability, but this doesn't use any language of what has come before this. It's just based on the frequency of words that you have seen. So we will refine this model, okay? So we definitely have a lot of information because of the things that we have heard before this coming word, mth word, right? So let's look at another refined model, which is P of WM given WM minus 1. What does that mean? Probability of word at mth location, this line means given the word at the previous location. So if you know the previous word is an adjective, you know that this word will most likely be a noun. If it is an adverb, then it will be a verb. So that narrows down your choices of words, okay? So now you will discard all the other words that don't fit this model. So when you have a pair of words, a model based on a pair of words, it's called a bigram model, bigram model. Similarly, if you look at two previous words, for the current word m, if you look at m minus 1 and m minus 2, then it will be a trigram model. Okay? So, and then three previous words. So here, you are trying to guess the current word based on three previous words. Okay? So that's a quadrigram model. Okay? So another game of a similar type. So let's say you are given a sentence and I have deleted all the words, you have to guess the last word. Okay. It's very difficult to guess it without knowing what was the previous word. Now, if I include one more word, you probably have some idea of what that would be. What it would be? It's a, let me give you a hint, it's a two-letter word. So I have narrowed it down very, very much. Yeah, something like that, right? Up, pick me up, right? Right. So you needed to go only up to here to guess the word. You didn't even need to go all the way down. Okay. So trigram model itself is very powerful in guessing the next word. You don't have to go to quadrigram and higher order probability models. Okay. So when we think of these models, what we are saying is that we need to know only previous n words, and n is a small number. In this case, we needed only the first, only the three previous words or two previous words. Okay. So if you look at a word and you are trying to guess it, you are trying to guess its probability from all possible words. So let's say in conversational English, we have 20,000 words. So out of 20,000, which word it is? And you base it on all the previous words, but you approximate this using just that word itself, that's a unigram model. If you approximate it using the previous word, then it's a bigram model. If you approximate it using two previous ones, then it's a trigram. And n minus one previous one, then it is a n-gram model. Okay, so this simplifies our model. So, but how many n-grams are there? Okay, so if you have 20,000 conversational words, for a bigram, you'll have square of 20,000 bigrams, right? You take any word from, and then any word for the second position. So you have 400 million bigrams. But they're not all used in language, right? For example, the is a common word, but the doesn't even make sense. So that bigram actually doesn't even figure in your language. So your actual space of all bigrams and trigrams is much less than what is all possible combinations of two words and three words. Okay. So when you make language models, you take that into account and you only learn the ones that you have encountered. Okay. But where do you encounter them? Okay. You encounter them, when you train these language models, you look at some corpora. Corpora is basically large collection of texts. Okay. So for example, all works of Shakespeare is a corpus. Then you have Wall Street Journal, a lot of articles of Wall Street Journal are available online for people to train machines on, and Thomson Reuters. Okay. So now if you train your bigram model or a trigram model on one of these corpus, then and you start to generate random sentences using that bigram model. So by random sentences, I mean you give it three words, and you ask it to guess the next one, and whatever is the most probable one, that put it there, and then the next one and next one, it will construct something that looks like a sentence, but it may not be a complete sentence. It turns out that if you use a quadrigram model, where you are looking at only four possible word, depending on its three previous words, you start to generate things that kind of start to make sense. Not only that, interestingly, if you train it on Shakespeare, it sounds like Shakespeare. It won't sound like Wall Street Journal. Okay, so this is an example of a machine generated, so a machine was given three words and it had to guess the next word. Okay. So it came with my, and then using these three, it has to generate the next one. Okay, so then it, in the next step, it came up with a word forlorn, and then prince. Okay. So now this may or may not be in Shakespeare, but it kind of sounds like Shakespeare now. So this is a machine generating random sentences based on just knowledge of three previous words. Okay. And it does not sound like Wall Street Journal at all, because it was trained on Shakespeare, not on Wall Street Journal. So how does it help us? Of course, it helps us in automatic speech recognition, right? So for example, let's say there was a sentence that you have a sound recording for, and it says there was a, it sounds like bear behind the bushes, right? So now the job of automatic speech recognition software is to assign a word to what it has heard. Sorry, I didn't use phonetic symbols here, but you guys know what phonetic symbols are better than me. So let's say it sounded like bear. Okay. Now, is it B-E-A-R or B-A-R-E? Or was it slight mispronunciation and was it B-E-E-R or B-A-R? Okay. So the job of speech recognition software is to first narrow it down to these four choices and then pick the right choice. Okay. And it does that based on this language model. So it can use, for example, things like part of speech, part of speech knowledge. If it has already passed the previous sentence and it knows that this is an article, it knows that a noun is coming next, right? And based on that, it can noun or an adjective, right? So based on that, it can narrow some choices. That may not help. Then it can just use previous words and an n-gram model, okay? But to actually resolve this, this requires that the machine has seen many, many examples of all possible n-grams. It's different from how humans work. We generalize a lot better, right? We don't need to go through the entire Shakespeare to make intelligent sentences, right? But the machine needs to go through entire Shakespeare, entire Wall Street Journal, and so forth, to start to make some intelligent sentences. Okay. Now, it also helps spell check software. Okay. So here, a language model will give you context for the words that are coming next, that the word that is being checked. So how many types of mistakes are there in spell checking? There might be different ways of categorizing mistakes. One way is that there are non-words and then there are wrong words. So what are non-words? For example, if someone typed this sentence, they wrote B-A-E-R. B-A-E-R is not a word, right? And wrong word is that this word is actually there in the dictionary, but it is not the right word, okay? There was a bear behind the bushes. So both of these will benefit from a language model, the n-gram model that I talked about, or more sophisticated models, to resolve both of these mistakes. So different types of, or different causes of spelling mistakes. Everyone who has done typing know that they have made such mistakes with some frequency, right? So for example, exchanging two letters. If it is B-A-A-R, A and E have been exchanged, okay? Then typing the wrong key. So YW, W is close to E on the keyboard. So you just, your finger doesn't land at the right place. Okay? Adding an extra letter. You pressed E too long. Okay? And, or you missed pressing E. Okay? And then wrong homophone. Words that sound alike, and in your hurry, or because someone didn't have the right knowledge, they type the wrong word, okay? So for example, for B-E-A-R, bear, B-A-R-E is also a homophone. And in some Indian pronunciation, B-E-A-R is also called beer, so B-E-E-R is also beer. Okay. And then OCR can also cause problems, optical character recognition. So if you have printed text and it is being scanned by a machine, the machine that recognizes the visual characteristics of a letter sometimes makes mistakes. E and C look alike. So for example, B-E-A-R can become B-C-A-R. So there are different types of mistakes. Why do we need to know about these different kinds of mistakes? Is because that will help us tell, if we have a wrong word, what would be the nearest right word? We have to have a sense for what mistake could have caused this. Clear? So let's look at what mistakes cause these, okay? So we need a model for word distortion. What causes a mistake? Okay. What is the probability of when you are typing to exchange two neighboring letters in a word? Okay. So let's say it is once every 20 words you exchange two letters. Okay. So that's your probability is 1 over 20. What is the probability of typing the wrong key? And does it depend on the distance from the right key on the keyboard? Of course it does, right? So if you want to type E and what is next to E, let's say W is next to E, you are very likely to press W as opposed to X, which is far away from E. Okay? And then what is the probability of missing a letter? So what this means is that if you are writing B-E-A-R and instead of E you press W, that is highly likely compared to pressing X, okay? So these two have different distances. The two wrong words have different distances from the actual right word. So that notion of distance between words is important because that helps you find what is the probable mistake you made, the one that is closer to the current word, to the wrong word, okay? The one that is far away is less likely to be the mistake that you made. So this distortion model that assigns some sort of a distance metric or a probability of wrong word given the right word is called the channel model. And this channel word comes from communication, where you are sending a signal over a communication channel and the received message is slightly different from the sent message because of atmospheric noise or electromagnetic noise and so forth. So that the same term has come here, where we are saying that it's not the electromagnetic noise, it's your finger noise, right, on the keyboard that has caused a distortion. Okay. So here are some examples of starting with B-E-A-R, bear, and having different edit distances to different words. Okay. So let's say we define an edit distance as either one addition or one deletion of a letter. Okay. One addition, one deletion, and let's say replacing one letter with another, for example. So let's say in this case you have B-E-A-R, with just one replacement you can go to F-E-A-R, okay? And if you want to go from B-E-A-R to F-A-R, you need to first replace a letter and then delete a letter. Okay, so that is distance of two away. Then from B-E-A-R to fear, to far, to fair is three distances away, right? So if your actual word were B-E-A-R, F-A-R-E is less likely compared to F-A-R, compared and even less likely compared to F-E-A-R. So there is a notion of relative distance between two words. Additions, and now there are different questions when you model this that you can answer based on people's behavior by observing many, many typings, that should additions and deletions have the same weight, same distance? What about exchanging two letters to B-E-A-R and B-A-E-R, right? And what about pressing the neighboring key? So when you answer all these questions, you will have a model of probability of a typed word given what was the candidate right word. Okay. So you can put all wrong words here, and you can put the word that you actually saw in the sentence and put all the possible right words and see which one is more likely. Okay. So this gives you a distortion model, a channel model. Okay. So we'll put it together. I shouldn't have put mathematics in here, but I will show you that it's not that difficult. What I want to show in the end, that if we take both models into account, the channel model, which is how words get distorted, and the language model, which word combinations are more likely, then we will get a sense for how to find the right word for a spell check. Okay, so it all depends on, it all starts with something called Bayes theorem. So Bayes theorem, forget about that. Let me go through the definitions here first. So let's say the word that was typed was W. Okay, and F was the phrase that came before. Let's say if it is a trigram, then the two letters that came before. And W dash is the candidate word. So W dash can be different possible correction suggestions. And you have to pick the right W dash. Okay. So which one will you pick? You'll pick the one whose probability is highest given the phrase and the wrong word that you already know. Okay. So probability of W dash given the actual word that was typed and the words that were typed before that. Okay, these two together. So given is shown by this line. So it turns out with some mathematics, if you start with this, you can actually show that the word that maximizes this is the one that gives you the maximum product of these two terms. What are these two terms? What is the probability of the typed word, possibly wrong word, given the candidate word, times the probability of the candidate word given the phrase? Okay. So this is your channel model and this is your language model. So you have to find the right balance between a product of both of these, right? So it has to have the most likely word is the one that led to the to distortion and makes sense language wise. So was it a bear or a hare? Okay, let's start looking at different possible suggestions. Okay, so let's say the sentence was, there was a bear, B-A-R-E, behind the bushes. And your candidates are B-A-R-E, which is the same word. So which means that you also take into account that there was no mistake made, especially if it was the wrong word, not the non-word. Right, it was not B-A-E-R, it was not the wrong word, but this is also an English word. So this is also a candidate. And then you also have hare and bear. Okay, so which one is it? So let's look at what factors you will consider. So we know that probability of bear given the, what that means is that we did not make a mistake. Probability that we did not make a mistake is high. Why? Because 90% of the times in words, we don't make a mistake. 90% of the times we type the right thing that we want to. So this is high, right? But if you look at the previous words, which is there was a, so bear given there was a is low but not too low, because it can also be used as an adjective. There was a bear child, right? But what tells us that it is not bear is rest of the sentence. So if you have a more sophisticated language models, then it will also be forward looking, not just backward looking. I didn't cover that in the lecture, but you can always have a more forward looking model. Now there was a hare behind the bushes also makes sense, right? So it has high what probability? Language model probability, not the, we haven't commented on the channel model yet. It has high language model probability. There was a bear behind the bushes also makes sense because it has a high language model probability, right? So now we have to look at the channel, okay? So in channel, what is the probability of bear given hare versus bear given bear? And we compare these two, and not just these two, but their product with their language models also. Right? So we know that H and B are far on the keyboard. So here given bear has a small channel probability, right? But we know that bear and bear are homophones, okay? But their letters that are changed are separated by R. So they are homophones, so they might have a low, they might have a high channel probability, but the reason to make a mistake because of typing error is small. It could be an error because of the homophone itself. So we don't know that. So the way to resolve this, I don't have an answer for this, but I know how we will get this, is that we should compare these three things. We should compare the product of bear given bear times bear given there was a. We should compare hare given bear times hare given there was a, okay. Bear given bear times where given there was a. Or if you have a more sophisticated model, then you will use the rest of the sentence also. Okay. So whichever of these three computes to be the highest will be the highest suggestion on your spell checker. Okay. And the one that gives you the next highest will be the next suggestion on the spell checker, and so forth. So this is, in a nutshell, how spell checkers work. So what we have not used in this so far, we haven't used any linguistic knowledge, right? We have trained these language models. We have talked about how to train these n-gram language models just on corpora, right, on large corpus. So we can also bring linguistics into it, okay? So what if there was an n-gram, a combination of n words, that was not in the corpus, then what will you do? Because then your language model probability for that n-gram will be zero, right? So there are mathematical techniques to say that every n-gram, even if it is unseen, should have some non-zero probability. Just give it some small number and use it in your spell checker. That's one way. The other way is that you actually use knowledge of linguistics. So for example, you can use knowledge of part of speech tagging, right? Part of speech can help. So that's another problem in natural language processing. So you are given a sentence, how do you tag a part of speech for each word that is there in the sentence? So I'll not go into that. And then you use linguistic knowledge. You use linguistic knowledge to uncover syntax, grammar, and part of speech patterns, right? So you know that there will be a noun phrase, there will be a verb phrase, and all that. So you use that to narrow down the choices of the word that you are trying to correct. Okay. And that word and its combination of the n-gram may not even be in the corpus, but you know that there has to be some noun here or a verb here or an adjective here, right? So based on that, you narrow it down, and then from those narrowed down choices, you find the one that has the smallest distortion between the intended word and the typed word. So for example, if you had a missing word here and you make a syntax tree, please pardon me if my syntax tree is wrong. What I know now is that this is a noun, and because of noun, I know that B-A-R-E will not be a part of this. Okay? So that's how I can use linguistic knowledge also to correct the spell checker here. Okay? So that's all. Thank you very much. If you have questions, I can take questions.
The first question is related to the difference between handwriting and keyboard.
Right.
The second question is related to the impact of technology on the mind, particularly computers. Are we losing our intelligence or memory because we depend more on computers? I see more these problems in young children or younger generation than in the older generation. Particularly, for example, T-H-I-N-K and T-H-I-N-G, some of the students, I shouldn't say for all students, some of the students don't make the difference. Similarly, W-H-E-R-E and W-E-R-E, they don't make the difference. Have the children become computers like?
To answer your first question, how will we treat handwritten language differently from computer language? The main difference will be in the channel model, right? The channel model will be very different for handwriting compared to typed text. Because the kind of mistakes that you make in both are characteristic to how you are writing that. To the second question, whether use of computers is making us less intelligent, I don't know if I have an answer to that. Perhaps it is shifting our intelligence from one domain to another. I think that's probably what is happening more. There is more types of knowledge to be kept in mind these days because there are so many things that you can actually indulge in terms of even language, interacting with language, for example. So I think the probably the focus of the mind is shifting. I don't know if it is making us less intelligent or more intelligent, but it's definitely shifting. And this SMS type language, it is definitely a pain point personally for me also when I see that in emails from students. And I just advise them that don't do this in a professional setting. People will judge you. But that is just a friendly advice for them.
I think also in the case of handwriting, your sound system becomes very effective, right? So when you're not looking at script, right?
Right.
I mean, you're using it, but the initiator is actually a sound,
right?
Or a cluster of sounds.
Right.
So in that case, if you have WERE and WHERE coming together or replacing each other incorrectly, you still are able to put the responsibility on the sound system. So it's probably not an error in that sense. Whereas in the case of a machine, that information, unless you have really put in the sound there along with the rest of the information, right, about where,
right?
So if you have put that. And I think that will be probably a big parameter, spoken language versus that.
Right.
Anyway, my question is, I'm trying to understand your system because it seems to be more like working on a linear array, right? And which is why I was very concerned when you kept on saying previous word or previous words. And then you said that, well, you can also look forward. So it's not just backtracking, it's also looking forward. So I'm still trying to understand where would a dependency come in from? Because what I know of computational linguistics from one of my colleagues in my department in Delhi, I think dependency grammar is very useful, right? And dependency grammar is all about the verb. It's very centered on the verb,
right?
Because the rest of the things seem to come from there.
Right.
Of course, you have dependencies within noun phrases as well.
Right.
And I was thinking, could you explain if dependency grammar could be useful for this kind?
So there are long-range dependencies in language, right? The word that you're trying to spell check could be informed by something that was even in the previous sentence, not just this sentence, or the next sentence, or even like the beginning of this sentence, of a long sentence. So the models that I've explained are very rudimentary. This is what I would give in a class assignment. The state-of-the-art spell checkers use much more long-range models. And the other reason is that, the other thing is that all these spell checkers, they are coming from commercial ventures, right? So they want to get a product out. And that the product, if it does 90% of the job with just like a trigram or a quadrigram model, they are happy to put that out. And that helps in a lot of situations. You might, with your experience with MS Word will tell you that it doesn't always give you the perfect answer. That is because it doesn't have the same kind of models that we have probably in our brain of long-range dependencies, better knowledge of language, internalizing language in some sense, as opposed to like just thinking of it as a statistical problem of given 5 words, what is the next word, and so forth.
See, dependency model or this syntagmatic relations are captured in this model. But when we look at languages which allow a lot of scrambling, where this linear rigidity is not there, so what will happen there? I mean,
you probably need a different language model,
languages,
of course.
Languages which are very rich in morphological,
right.
Morphosyntax and morphologically very rich. They allow a scrambling, they allow, so there is no linear rigidity for example, Sanskrit, or let's say French, which are morphologically very rich. So syntactic structures are not rigid.
Right.
Focalization is allowed, scrambling is allowed.
Right.
So ordering of the word is not a rigid parameter.
Right. Yeah, and even in automatic speech recognition, for example,
more
intonation,
more
right, in Chinese.
For that matter, Sino-Tibetan languages, they're full of such things. Markers are not there simply. Yeah, very, very, very little.
No, I was saying that even in automatic speech recognition, it's a problem. You cannot model all languages easily. There are some languages that are tone rich, right? So it's very, you need tone recognition and so forth to resolve the same utterance in different contexts.
Yeah, you were talking about corpora. When the computer relies on corpora, do you have one large corpus or is it based on the topic? Like you said, Shakespeare and Wall Street Journal are different.
Right.
So would there be a separate field for Shakespeare and a separate field for?
You'll probably have separate models for Shakespeare and separate model for separate language model for Wall Street Journal. Yes.
Okay.
Yeah,
thanks.
I just want to know how this Google Translator and all those kinds of things work.
I don't know exactly their technology because that's a proprietary secret they have, of course. But some of the things that they use are basically these language models itself, like these n-gram models, probably that's what they use. And they will probably have these models for two different languages and then they will also learn interconnect between the two. Based on a lot of examples of Spanish text translated to English by professional translators, they will learn this. Yeah. So a lot of what Google does is large-scale statistical machine learning, which means they have access to a lot of translated text, a lot of OCR and so forth. So, and the way they get it many times is at some point when you are logging into Gmail, they will ask you a question to solve an OCR. What they are using is they are giving it to three different people, and if two people agree, then they think that that is the right answer, and that goes to train their machine. Okay, so you are helping them train their machine by using Gmail and all these other services that they give you. So they give you good services to get data from you.
So is there any corpus or any way channel model to analyze direct speech and not the whole text, like the corpus from that, like you have the corpus or corpora, and from that I can analyze
from like speech?
From just direct, yeah, from the whole text I can.
From like a speech signal, like an audio signal or?
No, from written text. Is there a possibility or is there a model where I can analyze
I'm not aware of it. Okay. But we can search. I mean, there must be like a repository of like all speeches of some sort. Okay. Let's say politician speeches or something. Then you can make a computer sound like a politician. No.
Like from the written, from a written text, suppose I have a short story or something.
Yes.
And what I want to analyze is just the direct speech dialogue, of the speakers, dialogue.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, there are techniques to do that also. And there might be corpora that are available. A lot of probably Shakespeare's plays would fall into that.
Yeah, that's what I wanted. Like, right. If there is something of that kind, so it would be.
Yeah, I'm not particularly sure which one, but I think there must be some.
For NLTK, there's a corpus dedicated to the text that is used in internet conversations and forums. So maybe you can use that for direct speech, and that will be helpful. You were talking about training and all that. So I was thinking when we are doing spell check. Very often Google keyboard will take what you are typing in to use to train itself to specialize to you. Mm. What do you think about that data being sent to Google and being kept by larger companies just? So that is an issue that NLP does not address most of the time.
No, so NLP won't address ethical and business issues like that, right? It's solving an engineering problem.
Yeah, I'm just asking if we should, NLP should address an issue like that where the entire data privacy will be an issue.
You can have NLP solutions that respect your privacy, for example.
Yeah.
So you can have, let's say, for a software that learns it only on your phone and keeps the data only on your phone. That is possible. But whether someone will give you that software, that depends on your demand and the number of people demanding that.
So I have two questions, sir. Number one, the authenticity of these kind of stuffs. On what base, especially the corpus, what you said, is it reliable or something like that? The authenticity. I need the authenticity. Number two, if you provide these kind of stuffs to the students, I think they may lose their thinking ability. They will not think on their own. So what is your suggestion? Immediately they will get into that Google or whatever it is. They will not think. There is no time for them to think, to check the exact spelling, something like that, or even the guess.
I'm sorry, so for authenticity means, has the computer been trained on an authentic corpus? Is that the question? So these corpora are pretty standard. People know that, you can actually open Shakespeare and see that the corpus also has the same lines. So like Thomson Reuters and these Wall Street Journal and this Shakespeare corpus, they are pretty authentic. But in terms of thinking, losing thinking ability, that is true. But we are also losing our thinking ability while doing calculations, right? We still use a calculator. That is true. And like going back to that question about handwriting versus typing, when you are doing handwriting, especially cursive, the processes in the brain when you are doing actually joining letters is very different from when you are discreetly typing keys. Right, so you are losing one mental faculty and actually going into another territory altogether. So the question whether one is more intelligent than the other, I don't have an answer to that. Right, that all depends on where the humanity is going, where the evolution is taking us.
Join you in answering my good friend.
Please, yes, definitely.
You see, it is in the nature of human beings to be anxious. anxiety is part of our biological makeup. And anything that is new, including Susan Bright, sort of create a threat. So for example, when books came, Plato was critical. When fountain pens came in place of quill pens, or in my memory when jotter refills came, banks would not accept them, the checks written with jotter refills. Examinations could not be written in the 1960s with jotter refills. I'm sure Professor Patnaik will bear me testimony as the only other, you know, not so young person. You know, so it is in the nature of human beings to be anxious about new technology. But if you look at the history of writing, in all probability, Panini was illiterate. You know, the history of writing does not go beyond 3 millennium, and in India, it does not go beyond 2. Ashoka barely got his edicts engraved on some rocks at great expense, and which only Bill Gates today or Ashoka could afford it then. So Panini, in my opinion, was not likely to have written his aphorisms. He might have composed, and the students might have got them right. Dhanvil's anxiety is totally right. When you relegate the work to some other tool, to that extent, your body becomes weak. But I think you correctly answered him, you know, the gain is somewhere else. You do something else. When your driver drives the car, you sit down and enjoy music, or you think of newer ways of, you know, beating your wife or enemy. So I think, you know, recently I attended a meeting of educational administrators who were debating whether classroom teachers ought to have a laptop. And 9 out of 10 of them felt like Dhanvil has done. You know, that it will weaken the students. And this is the example I gave them, that when jotter refills came, actually, if I see it right, I don't want to get into technology forecasting, but, you know, writing and the entire technology that came with it, the hardware and the software. Software would be letters, hardware would be tablets or pen or paper. Have another 50 years at the most, when we will have very commonly voice-driven, you know, speech-driven, word processing packages, and you won't really need to write because the words could be recorded. Now, there was a time when, you know, when somebody in Bangalore offered a bribe to someone else and the court said, no, recorded speech will not be taken as evidence. Now it is routinely taken. A very celebrated journalist is facing trial in court because she offered to help some industrialist and her words have been recorded. So technology and civilization have had a running war where eventually civilization accepts new technology. So you can, on our behalf, assure Dhanvil, there is nothing much to worry about.
Thank you so much.